I don't think I need that.
Because I have a very strong presence. And I want you to hear me, and I want to use my hands. Thank you for being here. And for all of you guests, it's nice to see some new faces. I'm fairly new to the Women Owned Business Network. And today is pretty special for me. Because last year when I did win this scholarship, I knew what I wanted to work on. Because I asked my clients, what works for you? What have you learned in working with me? And what do you want to know more about? And they said, the chaos to calm stress scale. Most of them couldn't name it. They said, that stress scale thing. And I said, really? And they said, it's the most valuable tool I have learned. I want to know more about that and about your philosophy. And I thought, what do you want to know? And they said, well, you could spend a whole weekend on it. You could write a book about it. So I got to thinking, why don't I do that? So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the fourth edition or revision of my book. And let me tell you, when you write a book, it brings out the most wildest parts of your heart and soul. Sometimes it's more messy than you wish it to be. But this is expected to be published by end of summer, beginning of fall. So thank you, Weebon. From Chaos to Calm, Leading Change from the Inside Out is the book. So today is a snapshot of what's in the book, a little bit about the philosophy, and I hope that you walk away with at least one powerful tool. So I'd like to, and this is what I'm really good at, I over-engineer my speaking, and then I yank the rug out at the beginning. So I'm going to do this a little bit backwards, so bear with me. On your tables, you have a business card. You're welcome to take that home. You also have a post-it note. So hopefully there's enough pens in this room. Women always have a little extra of something. And I'd like for you to take a moment to check in. Our table topic was designed by me around stress. Nobody likes to talk about it. Nobody wants to have it. But it's actually pretty valuable, and we're going to talk about why. But I'd like for you to take a moment and rate yourself. On a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being chaos and disorder, and 1 being calm and order, how stressed are you? On a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being chaos and disorder, and 1 being calm and order, how stressed are you? So in a nutshell, the scale is a question. So go ahead and just write that number down, fold it over, don't think about it. We're going to get back to it. Life is about the hinges. The hinges that open the doors to opportunity and close the doors to catastrophe. How do we get in our own way? How do we lose ourselves in the chaos of a trigger event that we don't expect? The phone call in the middle of the night that says your mom has fallen the third time. Or that your child has had an accident. Or that your husband has lost his job, or that you now have a diagnosis. These things happen, and we can go from a sense of thinking we've got control to an erratic chaos in an instant. Or, over time, such as the Grand Canyon was formed by stress, we too can change over time. It can happen like this, or it can happen over time, but stress affects us. And we can work with it if we have the tools. We can develop resiliency in the presence of life because we can't quarantine ourselves off from that. So what's most important is to develop a sense of mindfulness because mindfulness is awakened decision-making. Mindfulness enables you to understand where you are, just like when you're plugging in your GPS because you want to go on a journey. You have to know where you are first so for you to go anywhere. So the Chaos to Calm Stress Scale is a measurement tool. How do you go anywhere? You map it. But stress is weird. You can measure ingredients to bake a cake. You can measure how heavy you are on a scale. You can look at the gas tank and see how much gas is in your car. But how do you measure stress? You can't, like, lay it out on the table, can you? I say you can. There's a couple of scaffolding mind frame, mindset that I'd like for you to kind of buy into. For this to work, we need buy-in. And the buy-in is three main components. And the first one is that everything is connected and that patterns are self-similar at every scale and that all knowledge leads to knowledge. So imagine everything is connected. To give an example, we can study ants and how they function to better understand how to design systems for traffic or systems to transport material. We can also study the Grand Canyon and understand how things fall apart. How does the ground change under pressure? So no matter the scale, size, patterns are self-similar at every scale. So if we buy into everything is connected and that we are one, there's nothing to fix. Because if we're in a constant state of something is wrong and I have to fix it, and now that thing is wrong and I have to fix it, now that thing's wrong and I have to fix it, we can get caught in a jetty and wind up far from where we would like to go. So if this assumption is that everything is kind of a part of an unfolding happening, then we can more be, like, on for the ride. That's interesting. Well, that sucks. And that's interesting, too. And, wow, I have found the awe in something awful. I found the awe in something awful. To hold a sense of fascination, curiosity, even in the face of something that is extremely challenging, like life. So perspective is that second buy-in, that no matter where you stand, you see things differently. If you were a microbe on your plate, looking up, you would see a very different world right now. Or if you were a bird on the tree, you would see a different world right now. Or if you were sitting on this side of the room looking here or this side of the room looking here. Perspective dictates our understanding of what we're experiencing. So we think we know something, but then we change a perspective, and then all of a sudden that thing that we think we know changes. Whoa, what a tool. And it could really mess us up. Because if we're thinking where we don't want to be thinking, our whole experience could be completely different than what we want it to be. So that's the second buy. And the third is, and I don't think I have to tell you guys this, life is change. Newsflash. Change is life. And life is also chaos. And life could be very stressful. I'm not a scientist yet. I wish I could play one on TV. But I love quantum physics, and there's a law, third law of thermodynamics called entropy. Anyone know about entropy? It's a new one. So entropy states that nature is designed to perpetually fall into disarray, chaos, and mess. But I bet every single one of us understands that, because if you don't clean out your desk or your email box or your car, or go to the bathroom and do what we have to do, things back up. It takes work for things to maintain. It's like, really? Do I have to work that hard? Yeah, science says so. But there's a positive to that. And the positive is when you're working to keep something, what are you keeping? What are you placing your efforts on to keep that thing going? Because maybe it's okay to let it go. Maybe it's okay to let it dismantle. Maybe it's okay to free it to become its next thing. When you think about an ocean, a wave comes up and out over to create the wave. So it rises up out of a whole body, and it crests, and then it becomes real messy and chaotic at the edge. It's like, which way is it going to go? It's got a lot of power, and then... And sometimes we get caught in the ebb, in the ebby, in the ebb and flow. But sometimes we're like a cork on the water, and you can just watch it and just bob along. So that perspective is important. And holding a sense of an appreciation that nature will constantly push us towards chaos. Constantly. So why fight it? Life is stress. Who's stressed? I'm curious about the numbers there. But stress is actually good because it indicates that there's life, that there's energy, that there's life force. Think of a plant. It's got to stress and crack through the earth for it to be what it needs to be. Wow, how much energy it takes to move through the crust of the earth. And we do that every day. Get out of bed. You know, we have our own little crusts to push through. We have to always keep cleaning, keep being aware of what's there. And so stress is that mechanism inside of us that's functioning, that's telling us, hey, is it safe to go here? Is it safe to do that? Because our amygdala, which is in the back of the brain, is sending chemicals through our body telling us, don't go to the edge of the cliff and jump off. It's dangerous. It wants you to survive. So it's keeping you safe. It's letting you know, you want to fight this neighbor? Or do you want to flee? Or maybe we can have a conversation. So it's all working behind the scenes. Stress. With stress, you can hit a deadline. With stress, you can end a marriage that isn't working. With stress, you can forge ahead. With stress, you can experience an orgasm. Think about that. You could also have a heart attack and die. These are all the moments of life, right? Think about that. Woo. But it's the regulated stress that causes momentum that we can be aware of, and it's the unregulated stress that causes a mess. So it's a little bit of a fine line because messes are going to happen anyway. We will get that call in the middle of the night to say, your father's on a ventilator, or there's been an emergency. That does happen. But having the tools to handle the chaos that is life makes it not only more bearable, but so much more enjoyable, because then you are really navigating the ebbs and flows of change. Because life is pain. Upset is optional. And to find that awe in what could be awful. So what's the best tool? Awareness and mindfulness. So we're going to start to slide into, let me check my time. We're going to start to slide into the scale. So I said it's hard to put stress on a table, but I believe we can in a certain way. You can measure it this way, length, 1 to 10, on a scale of 1 to 10, how stressed you are you? And you can also measure the depth, your relationship to your environment, things out there, people, engagements, stuff, and also measure depth in here, thoughts, behaviors, feelings, but we have to gather information in order for that to work. How do you know where you are? You measure it. So this is what I created. This is the chaos to calm stress scale. Ta-da! Why is it important? Because how would you feel if you owned a car and you couldn't tell whether there's enough oil in it or whether there's enough gas in it? I mean, you'd have to kind of play it by ear. After five times of you getting stuck on the side of the road, you might start realizing how many miles can you actually go. Well, we don't really think about stress as something you can measure, but I encourage you to start today by embedding in your brain, on a scale of 1 to 10, what is my stress? And I've broken it into three sections for a reason. And it goes back to the hinge. Life is about the hinges. May I have a volunteer to hold this up for a moment? You've been holding checks all day, darling. But you're good at it. So more people are familiar with this end of the scale. They're really familiar with the chaos, with the end of the line, the end of the rope. I've had it. I am so stressed. We get that. There's a misnomer, and we think, well, this is vacation. This is the weekend. That's my day off. I don't have to think over here. And sort of that's the case. But throughout an entire day, you can have moments that go from one end to the other. I have these labeled that this is response and this is reaction. So when you're not thinking, and I think we talked about this at the table during lunch, our table topic, when you're not thinking because you're in high stress, you're in survival mode. So you're doing nothing but reacting in the moment without even thinking. But here, you're able to respond, have more time to think. There's more space. Right in here is the hinge that opens the doors to opportunity and closes the doors to chaos. And in between each number is another hinge. And when you become aware of what each number represents for you, then you can access that hinge. Thank you. So what on earth is that like? So this is my personal experience, and every single one of us, I'm sure, could talk about a chaotic moment where we can say this was really terrible in our life. I've had a good many of them. You could read about them in my book. But this particular chart came out of me having a dance with chronic pain. I gained 30 pounds. I couldn't walk. I was suicidal. I was having a very hard time with my business during all of this time. And I hit that proverbial wall. And on that day, when I thought, I can't take this anymore, I have to end my life, I began to think, what am I really trying to kill off here? What am I trying to end? Pain. Well, how do you end pain? You don't. Because if pain is there, then pain is there. You have to be with it. You have to sit with it. And we have such a variety of different pains in our life. So how do we sit with a pain? First, we have to listen to it and know that it's there. It's kind of like having a guest in the house that you don't want. And you can't get them out. What does any good ghost catcher do? They bring in a team to talk to the ghosts. So you have to kind of talk to that. And the first thing that I started to do was listen on this scale of 1 to 10. If you've been to the doctor's office, they said, ma'am, what's your pain on a scale of 1 to 10? You know, and they have that little smiley face and what have you, and that's about it. And you're like, it hurts! But really, you don't know until you have a child or you lose a leg. You're like, what is the 10? What's your marker? So I started gathering and I started jotting down information. And I created this chart, the internal environment, which is everything about what's happening inside my brain and in my body, my physical sensations, the phenomena, my senses, my mind talk. And then the external environment, observations of relationships, tasks, engagements with the world. So I started to fill it in, and it took me 2.5 years to gather enough data to fill this chart. 2.5 years of daily noticing. And then I would move something and go, oh, that's not in a 7, that's a 9. Or that's not in a 3, that's a 6. Or, oh, that's what a 2 is. Now, I know this is really small, but, and it's really for real, like this is very small in real life. When you print it out, it's very small. It's the smallest font possible. But you can read it with a microscope. And so to put this into perspective, like reaction zone for me here when I'm in chaos is tight chest, ear ringing, ending it all, clenched jaw, I cry easily, I have an eye twitch that I'm aware of, headaches, yelling to shut down mode. Here is the physical world, unable to socialize, unable to manage tasks. Communication and outreach is scarce. I might binge eat or drink here. Non-essential appointments canceled. I close the doors to the shop of me. I don't engage. But a flip side is here, between the 6 and the 7, fairly social. I pay attention to things. My nails are done. My body's taken care of. I'm able to multitask. I listen to podcasts. I'm able to take information in, and it actually sticks. Versus here, it just begins to ramp up my stress as I'm filling myself with more information, and it begins to push me more off to the edge. Take classes, camping trips, bike rides. Like, I'm able to just maneuver through life. But here, I'm maneuvering, but I'm really tugging at the ground to get places and tugging at the world, if that makes any sense. And the flip side is here, for the response zone, this is where I say acceptance of what is. I say things like, I choose. I'm a more aware, I'm actively practicing internal forgiveness. Here I take long baths, deep cleaning, mindful me time, solo activities, no social contact. I am in repair mode here. And right around here, maintenance of my business, relationships, space, house stuff, exercise. Now, although exercise has to happen at all places, I seem to be more capable here. So we could talk about this all day. Like my client said, I want a workshop on that, you know, or a retreat. There's a lot of information there. But the most valuable part that I hope that you're taking from this is you don't know unless you start looking. And the only way you could start looking and gathering is to be okay with being vulnerable. Nobody likes to be vulnerable. I have a whole profession working with very successful overachievers who hate vulnerability. They pay me a lot of money, and I love helping them be vulnerable. Because when you're vulnerable, you can do something with that wave of change that is dragging you under. So at the end, it's all about responding and regulating versus reacting. And through my experience, this is going to be like an additional tidbit, and it might hit you right in your heart, or it might be like, what? That's way too much information. But what I've gathered over time, and when I step back and I see this pattern, I see this for everyone. I've worked with people since 1992, and that is three pillars of resiliency. Resiliency is that capacity to bounce back. to repair. And those three pillars are mindfulness, developing a sense in your own way of being aware of what you're aware of. Nature. Immersing yourself in nature, being in nature, involving yourself in some kind of nature by understanding your own nature first. So it's kind of an external nature and an internal nature. And the third is creativity. Now, I have been an artist where I've created art and then I sold it. But the most powerful thing that I experienced in my deepest, darkest places of life was that when I engaged in a creative act for the sake of process, not product, for the sake of process, that means let it be messy, don't make it about perfection, just get involved, it enabled me to access a back door to release stress and express something that I might not have words for. In the art therapy world, it's called decentering. I studied all about this. It's fascinating. And so these three pillars of resiliency, I can almost guarantee you every single person in this room can access these tools. But you've got to find your own individual expression of it. Because my expression of creativity or mindfulness or of nature is going to be different from yours. And that's the power of having the scaffolding and then you kind of putting your own stuff inside of it. And then that makes it sustainable for you. Lastly, people talk about balance, wanting to get balanced. It's hooey. Balance is not real. It is impossible because balance is movement. It's not a fixed state. It's like being a surfer. And we want our life and our situation to be an absolute, an end result. And trying to achieve that is taxing. It's exhausting. So take a moment to consider that leading change from the inside out starts with understanding your own relationship to chaos and calm. And what's that like for you? So I invite you to play with the edges of life, to get a little messy, and to figure out what's that like for you, and begin to gather. So I'm going to turn this around to you for just a moment. And everyone with me, we're going to take three deep breaths. So get your wiggles out in your chair. I know it's freezing in here. We probably have not aged. Just so you know, the last 30 minutes, nobody's aged because it's so cold. So wiggles out. And then if you'd like, please close your eyes and take a nice deep belly breath. And the belly breath means let it out. Nobody's looking at your belly. Let it get real fat and soft. Let your shoulders drop. And take a nice deep breath. Inhale through your nose and exhale through your mouth. Take another deep breath and allow this breath to really expand and find all the nooks and crannies inside of you that are stressed, that have been holding themselves, and release it with an audible from your mouth. And then take another deep breath and tell your body you are all right. And on your exhale, begin to roll your shoulders up, back, and down. Wiggle your fingers, wiggle your toes. You move your head side to side. And I'd like you to, when you're ready, return to the room. And remember this. On a scale of 1 to 10, how stressed are you? And if you catch yourself anywhere beyond a 6, do what I just taught you. Because 3 breaths is the modern equivalent of telling your Neanderthal cousin, hey, dude, back up. Everything is okay. So calm yourself so that you can be more mindful, be more creative, and play with the edges of life instead of shut them off or push them back because they're too much. So rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10, and then notice your numbers and see if they're any different than the number that you have written down already. On a scale of 1 to 10, what is your stress right now? Considering what you've learned, considering what you've gone over. And then I'd like to take 30 seconds, because we're running out of time, and I'd like for you to turn to someone near you and share your number. And if you don't want to share your number, then share what you would like to take from this talk. What has been powerful for you? 30 seconds each.
Wonderful.
You have a card? Would you like to
share? You and I are cut from the same cloth, my dear.
Thank
we
you.
Are kindred spirits.
That's what I thought. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I knew when I read about you, when I read about your bio and the speech, I'm like, oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Pleasure meeting you. Yeah, you as well. Okay.
Make sure that you both get turned. Okay, ladies, thank you. Did everybody get turned? Okay. Everybody get turned? Thank you. Before I completely close this off, I'd like, if you want to join my email list, I'd like to pass this box around. Please put your card in the box. If you need an extra card, I've got that here. If you don't have a card because you kind of forgot it, I have a little piece of paper. If you want to join the email, you can just write it here. So I'm going to pass this around and make sure it goes quickly so that everyone has it, and we're going to wrap up. How many of you moved 2 points? How many of you moved 3 points? How many of you moved 4 or more? Or more. Okay. How many of you stayed the same? Okay. So there's good variety, and we learned a little something. Does anyone want to quickly share an aha? Anything remarkable that they would like to say?
Well, we were just talking about it, and one of the things you were saying was about moving to the next thing, let's fix it. Move to the next thing, let's fix it. I'm a fixer, so I really heard that. And, you know, the trouble is when you're looking to fix something that's not your job to fix, and it's their job to fix it, and that's what fits me into the red zone.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Good noticing.
I got that, you know, so that helps me bring my number down.
Good noticing. Anyone else? Last comment? Yes.
I want to say that I used Annelies as a coach when I was going through a difficult time a couple of years ago, and all I can say is now I know what you meant.
That's pretty powerful. Yeah, because, you know, it's great to have tools. Like, you can have keys to a car, but if you don't know how to drive, that's not a very healthy for anybody. You know, you're out just driving around. So feel your feelings and remember this information. And I thank you for your listening.
You.
Madam.
Good to know. I'll talk to you.
All right. That didn't have an impact. Yes. Please. We have 2 hours for
my goodness. Thank you. Oh, is this from that flower lady?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Oh, nice.